Now that my line drawing is complete, I'm going to do a color study of the subject matter. The color study, sometimes referred to as a poster study, is a very simplified version of the painting. In fact, I recommend that you paint smaller. My painting's going to be very small. It's like 4 inches by 6 inches. It's going to be a very small painting. It's not going to be a good or a beautiful painting. It's going to be very simple. What I'm trying to do is I'm trying to posterize the colors. So all the complexities that exist in the actual still life, like complex gradations, things of that nature, I'm going to force myself to simplify it into very flat, simple colors. This is going to force me to get serious about what colors I'm going to need on my palette later on. So this is another one of those things where I'm just worried about what colors I'm looking at and how to make them. And so I'm not worried about composition any longer. That's already solved. I'm not worried about making a beautiful painting. That'll be solved later on. Right now, I'm just worried about calculating color information. Now, the color study is one of those things that I sometimes do before the actual line drawing. Why? Because I can quickly explore compositions this way. And so sometimes I will do a color study or two or three, whatever it takes, of the subject matter to see if that's the painting I want to create. And if so, then I go and I work up a detailed line drawing like I did in the last video. So it's one of those things where you could try it both ways and see which works best for you. For my color study, I quickly drew out the composition just very quick. It was a matter of minutes, and it's on an old piece of scrap canvas that I had that happened to be the same gray as my painting to come. And I've got a palette set up, and I've got all of my colors arranged, and I've got a whole assortment of neutral grays. This is going to help me reduce the chroma of each color. So the goal here is to figure out some of the major colors. So I'm going to be calculating what's this blue-greenish color here in the highlight area of the teacup. And then I want to calculate, well, what's the form shadow area? So just the big stuff, the form light, the form shadow. I want to calculate that stuff. Naturally, the backdrop. So I'm going to be calculating what this color is up here and over here, and this is where we're going to be using those aperture cards. These will prove really handy, because what I find is we think the backdrop is one uniform color, but when you go and you hold up the aperture cards, you'll actually find that usually there's a shift there. And I'll be figuring out what the color is here on the front of this tablecloth and the top of the tablecloth. So I'm basically going to be going around and just calculating the colors and then blocking them into this painting. I'm not trying to make a pretty painting. I'm just trying to figure out the colors so that I know what to use in my official painting. So the large painting, the one that matters. So this is when I did the drawing, I was calculating the heights, the widths, the proportions, the shapes of everything, and the composition itself. Now I'm calculating the color. So I'm taking things one step at a time, getting it right, and then when I go to sit down to paint, it's going to go so much smoother. Now, how do you figure out the color? Let's start off with the teacup. So if we look through the aperture card. And by the way, make sure these aren't tilted up or tilted down, especially when we start putting samples of paint on them or chips. If we put this in position and we look through, that gives us an isolated view of the color. And the reason this is important is because there's way too many illusions at work when we look at color. We tend to see things when we see things in context around other colors, sometimes we have a wildly incorrect perception of what that color is. And so the aperture card allows us to see the color for what it is without being influenced by the colors around it, because there are way too many illusions that we can fall prey to. So
we've got this color, now we need to mix it up. Now, I'm going to show you a couple ways. Now, because I use the Munzel Book of Color, I have the advantage of just working with the different chips. So I can go through the book and I can pull out different chips and I can do things like this, where I can go, all right, let me find that color that's in the form light. That's close, but it's a little too chromatic. So this was a 10 green, value 8, chroma 6. So I'm gonna drop it down to a chroma 4. So it's the same hue, same value, but a different chroma. So try to get that in place so you guys can see it. And that's it. That's gonna be the closest match that I have for the chips that I have. And you just wanna be reasonable about this. You can't go crazy trying to get everything to, you could spend all day trying to get an exact color. We just wanna be reasonable about it. This is good. So now I have some valuable information. I know that the form light area of the teacup is going to be a 10 green 8 4. So I'm just going to put this right up here. And so now I need to make that color. And if you don't have the Munzel book, hang around because I'm going to be showing you ways to do this without the Munzel book, and it's going to help you greatly. So don't run away just yet. So my mixture is far too blue. And it's not light enough. I think I've got a pretty decent match here. I'll know in a second. But as I was adding white, the hue kept shifting over to blue, so I had to take some yellow and knock it back over. And that's why using chips is so helpful, because you can see whether the hue is shifting or not. So what I can do right now is I can take my palette knife, and one of the benefits of working with these glossy chips is I can wipe it on the chip to see if I have a match. And I think that's pretty much a dead ringer right there, okay? But if you don't have the Munzel book, what you can do is you can do this instead. I'll show you something. So you can go like this. You can take the color in question, and you can wipe it on a piece of paper like this. So this is a little piece of scrap paper. Okay, so I have a little piece of paper like that. And then you can go back to your aperture card, and then you can put that in place, and then you can hold it and see how you did. It's hard to see from my viewpoint. There we go. Okay, so you can see how close of the match the color is. And so you don't need the Munzel chips to actually do this. You can just build out all of your colors on these little sample cards. This is just index card that I cut up. Now, what you're going to want to do is you're going to want to write down your recipe. I mean, if you spent a few moments trying to figure out this color, you're going to want to write down, how did you make this color and what is it going to be useful for over here? And this is where you can go back to your sketch and you can write these things down. You could label this, I don't know, paint swatch A, and then you can put an A right here, and then you'll know that that's the color you're going to be using there. I just paint that color in. Now it looks like the form shadow on that teacup is right around a 5G 5.2, so that's a value 5 chroma 2, very low chroma. I know if I was just painting this by eye, I probably would have painted that form shadow with too much intensity, too much chroma. But because I'm using the chips and we're looking through an aperture, I'm able to see that color for what it is. F-
front of the tablecloth seems to be right around there. Now what's nice about working with the chips is, since I know the value of this chip, which is a 7, and I know the chroma, 4, I can work with my neutral grays. And so since this is a value 7, well, I've got my value 7 right here. And if I ever need to reduce the chroma of any color that's a value 7 color, I just add some of this neutral gray and it'll bring the chroma right down. It'll make that color less intense. Okay, so I want to show you what's happening here on my palette, because this is totally a real world thing that happens all the time. So I'm mixing this color, and I didn't think I was going to need anything redder than this is a Hansa Yellow Deep. And I didn't think I was going to need anything redder here, but as I'm mixing this color and I'm lightening the value, I can see that this is more red, whereas the color I'm getting is too yellow. And I'm maxed out over here. This is as red as I've got on my palette. So I need to actually go into my paint kit and I need to get something a little more red over here to pull this back towards red, because even with this orange color right here, it's far too orange, far too yellow. So I need to kick it back over towards red. So I'm gonna add some red to my palette. So I went and I grabbed a cadmium orange and a cadmium red, and that's gonna help adjust this hue and push it over towards red, because even working with this Hansa Yellow Deep, it's too yellow. So I'll start conservatively with the cadmium orange. And I added a little bit of cad orange to that mix. And I can already see that the hue is probably a lot closer, but it's a little too dark in value and it's too chromatic. I need to drop the chroma. So how do I do that? Well, I know I've got my N7, and this is a 7 value. So the N7 will drop the chroma, but I also need to make it a little bit lighter. So I'm gonna adjust the value first. Getting really close now. I didn't need to use that cadmium red after all. The cadmium orange shifted the hue over nicely, and I was able to use my neutrals to drop the chroma. And there are ways of doing this precisely. This is something that I teach my private students. We go over methods for finding exact colors. And it does take a little while, but once you understand how to do it, you really can mix any color. And then you don't have to rely on recipes or really anything like that. You know the color space and you know how to work within it. So I'm gonna say that's good. That's close enough. When I paint these color studies, I try to use the largest brush I can get away with. That also forces me not to get into details. It's tempting. It's often tempting to get nitpicky about gradations and little things. However, I have to remind myself that I am just here to get the basic colors. I'm just gathering color information. That's all I'm really doing. Now, I made an assumption here that this was all the same color, and I doubt it's all the same, so I'm gonna have to take some readings and probably make a few adjustments there. Now, the question I get sometimes is, you know, how much measuring do you do? Do you have to measure everything? And the answer is, you need to measure enough to make a good-looking painting, give you information on what to paint and how to paint it accurately. So when you're working within a series of colors, so this was for the table top, and this was for the table side. So now I have basically two endpoints, and I can mix between the two. So a lot of the stuff that I do for little ripples or little value changes, I don't have to measure everything and remix it. I mean, a painting would never get done. So once you have two endpoints right here, this was the lightest part of the tablecloth, and this was the majority of the top. Now I can mix between them and play around and get some of those steps in between. So you don't have to measure and mix everything right on its own. I mean, we have to be reasonable with this whole process. Now I'm going to go in for some of those cast shadows. I was taking some measurements earlier, and they appear to be a 10 yellow red value 2 chroma 2. And this is where your earth colors are handy, because when you're down near those really dark values, and you need a little bit of chroma, that's where these earth colors are handy. So that's a burnt umber. We can already see that that's reasonably close. Probably just a little too chromatic. You know, actually just a little, maybe just a touch too red. So I can add some raw umber to it, which is a little bit more yellow. And then, so I added a little more raw umber to it to bring it back towards yellow. And I reduced a little bit of that chroma with my neutral number 2. And I think that's right around where I need it. I have to say, though, when you start painting, everything seems wrong. So if you decide to paint using this process where you're measuring things, and just understand you're going to feel like it's all wrong, especially the first few areas, and nothing seems right until it's around color. Because remember, we're seeing a still life next to other colors. And when you put down colors at first and there's nothing for them to be around, it just doesn't seem right. And I can't tell you how many times, I mean, it happens just about every time. I want to believe I'm completely wrong, and I just tell myself, just go through the process and trust your measurement calculations, and things will work out. And it's like every time they do, if you just slow everything down and take the time to measure. One of the nice things about working on a gray canvas is if you miss your edges by just a small amount, it really isn't too offensive. Whereas if you had a pure white canvas and you left a gap, I mean, stuff just looks terrible. I think this is one of the reasons a lot of people like painting grisaille or their underpaintings. I know when I've done them, that was one of the things I enjoyed, was if you missed little spots, you always had a color showing through. So I did a lot of grisailles in raw umber, so I would have a bit of a yellowish color coming through, right? And that was a lot better than a pure white. But I'll tell you what, since I know how to measure color and I take my time accurately calculating my color from the beginning, like what I'm doing right now, I really don't have to do grisaille anymore. I mean, there's almost no point. As long as I'm working on gray and I take the time to calculate all my colors ahead of time, there's just no point. I think I used to do them, and I think a lot of people are just impatient. They just want to get painting. And by slowing everything down, I've really not only become a better painter, but I've enjoyed the whole process a lot more because I make far fewer mistakes when I paint now. And we know there's a little bit of that color creeping in there. In fact, this is a good time to give you a little bit of theory here. Well, we've got our light, which is coming from my left shoulder, coming down on these objects this way. And what's blocking the light? Well, these objects, the teacup and this little creamer pitcher here, is blocking the light. So that's what the cast shadow is. But what color comes to fill in is the backdrop. So we have this massive area back here. So if this backdrop was like bright red, we would notice a lot of brighter red in the cast shadows, because that's what's influencing the color over here the most. And so when you're mixing colors and you're thinking about, well, what hue is it, you always have to look around the scene and ask yourself questions. I know this color is having an influence here. So it's almost like a mathematical thing where it's the local color of the tablecloth top plus the local color of this equals the hue here, and then we have to drop the value in the chroma. Whenever things go into the shadow, the value drops, of course, and the chroma drops as well. But all this stuff can be measured. We can use our aperture cards, our little paint swatches. Here's the original one that I did. Or the Munzel chips, which I really like. They've been probably one of the best investments ever. We can figure all this stuff out. Inside of the teacup, where it's lightest in value, is about a 5 yellow, value 8.5, chroma 1. And this is one of these things, it's so hard to figure out just by eye, but when I use the chip, it makes so much sense. And this is where working with a color space like Munzel is just wonderful. So I can take a yellow that's around a 5Y yellow. So I've got this yellow. Let's say it's right around 5Y. And it's actually around an 8 value, somewhere around there. Okay. And what I can do is I can drop the chroma with a neutral. So all I really need to do is take my neutral. This is my N8, and I can. This is my N8, and I can drop the chroma until I get there. It's just such a pleasurable way of mixing paint. See what I have. Okay, that's getting very close. It's just a little too dark since I'm mixing in N8. It is dropping the value a little bit, but I think the chroma and the hue are pretty good, so I'm just going to lighten that up with a small amount of white. You've probably heard too that white will, people say, well, white cools your colors, and it's true. I mean, it will kick it over to blue, but there's nothing left I can do here. To lighten this yellow, I have to add a little bit of white, and I'm just adding a small amount. So I don't think I'm losing it too much. I think I'm right around where I need to be. And once again, if you're not using the Munzel color space, you just need to think of these things. You need to make little swatches, put them up, use your aperture cards, and measure the color out. And once it's in front of you, it's a lot easier to evaluate, to be able to see if something is too red or too yellow, if something's too chromatic or too light in value, too dark. All these things are a lot easier when you have a controlled way of viewing the color. Remember, the color study isn't supposed to be a highly developed painting. So it's just there to help you calculate what colors you are going to need in your painting. So you really got to put the brakes on the details and the fancy gradations and things like that. If you find yourself getting into the nitpicky things with a little brush, you really got to put the brakes on and remind yourself, keep the color study really basic. So now that we've got our colors figured out, we're going to go to the next phase, which is pre-mixing our paints. So I'm going to move over to my large glass palette, and I'm going to mix paint strings up of all the major colors that I'll need in the painting.